In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In the crown, his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then thirsting for in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Good morning, one and all. Hi, Don. How you doing? Okay. I'm getting there. Let's see what we got for announcements real quick. Finance Committee meeting this Tuesday at 6:30. We got a charge conference coming up. That's why we got the Finance Committee. So don't everybody freak out, okay? It's time to have a Finance Committee every quarter. So the work day is next week. Also, we have a chicken queue next week, Sydney. So you get to buy chickens and clean up. But you got to buy the chicken. And his chicken is good. Our week to serve at Lord is My Help is next week coming up. Get with Linda. And then we have the new young adults class. What? What's today? Tomorrow's what? Okay, so the next week would be the 27th, would it not? Monday, tomorrow is this week. Next week would be the 27th. I understood it. Did you understand it? I tell you what, get with Linda if you want to serve. How's that? Whatever week it is. They'll take you any week. Just, they need help. If you're visiting with us today, we appreciate you coming and worshiping with us. We do have a website, and we'd love your feedback. You can find that on there. It's www.wesleyos.org. So please let us know. Charge conference has been rescheduled to the 18th. Now, I need to recognize some folks real quick. Ann, Wanda, Giff, Terry, Stan. I want y'all to know, and we got other ones, but these were at our class this week of our lay servant ministry, and I sure do appreciate it very much for y'all coming and serving. Kay, Patty, and Phil, I think are, did I miss anybody that's also a lay servant ministry? No? Great, it was a great class. This was, I've taught it now three times. This was my best that we've had, I think, overall. Not just my class, but all the classes that we had. It was a lot of fun. I'm very proud of Wesley, by the way, to have the size congregation we have, to have that many lay speakers or lay servant ministers in it. I looked around the room yesterday, and I don't think there was anybody there from any of our larger churches, which kind of is counterintuitive to me. It would seem like if I had a larger church, I'd need more folks to help. But what do I know? Dumb redneck preacher. All right. Any other announcements? Hey. How you doing? Thanks, Cindy. Anything else? I'm always the last to know, so. Hey! So what you're saying is, if you got something in that shed that you are just attached to, they need to come get it.
No, I'm saying we need labor.
We ain't keeping all that stuff. All right, good deal. I don't know. I mean, you know. I'm going to start on this side of the room for prayer concerns. Maybe Don will be quiet by then. Prayer concerns. No? Going to this side of the room. Hey, Sydney. Yes, ma'am.
I'm
you're sitting on my hat, we're going to have some serious problems over there. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Hey, Judy. Glad to see you back. Let us join our hearts in prayer then. Gracious God, we are so thankful that we are able to come into your house once again. We come to offer up in gratitude our worship to you. That we come to thank you for all the blessings that you have laid on our feet this week. We come also to confess to you that sometimes we just don't do too good a job. That we are more interested in ourself than we are in others. We ask that you help us to continually thank you for what you have done for us. We ask that you give us courage and strength to be your people, that we can go out and make disciples, not just members. We ask that your presence be felt here, that your spirit moves amongst all of us. We ask you to help us to discern your will. Quieten us so that we can hear you and strengthen us with courage to act upon what you tell us. We also come together to pray for those whom we love, for Leon. We ask you give him peace that passes all understanding. We pray for Judy that we're so thankful that she is back, that your healing hands have been laid upon her. For Rachel and for Opal, as they go through this time and this journey, that you journey with them, that you give them comfort and strength and guidance along the way. We pray all these things with the one who has taught us how. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand and join us.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Forever I love you, forever I stand. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
Our hymn is I Surrender All, and we'll be doing verses 1, 3, and 4 for those of you playing along at home.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
We've got new people here today, or people at least I don't know, and that's always good, huh? Have you guys had a busy week? I had a busy week. Did you guys have school Monday and Tuesday? What does Jesus Christ mean? Jesus is his name, and Christ means he's the Savior. He's the Messiah that God promised. You didn't. Okay. Come here again. You can ask me in a second, okay? You gonna hold that for my bucket?
Sure.
Okay, so here's what I wanted to talk about. We had Monday and Tuesday off of school. I was gone to a class all weekend. And the reading fairs at school this coming week. Do you ever guys just feel overwhelmed? Is it not on? Oh, sorry. Now can you hear me? You ever just feel tired? You just wake up in the morning, you're like, I want to play, but I'm tired. I want to do this after school, but I got homework. You know, that's Nathan. Mama, don't make me do my homework right now. Please don't make me do my homework right now. In life, God gives us responsibilities and things that we have to do, and sometimes we don't want to do them, do we? We don't like cleaning our rooms. We don't like putting away the laundry. Don't like doing schoolwork.
I like putting away the laundry.
You do like putting away the laundry? Can she come home with me? I need some help. Anyway, so what I wanted to tell you is some of us have less energy than others, and Miss Ann has a disease, and sometimes I wake up so tired in the morning, I don't even want to get out of bed. And so I pray in the morning, I say, oh God, I have all this to do today, and I feel overwhelmed. But you know what? God says he's there with us in the good times and the bad times, and he's there for us when we feel good, and he's there for us when we feel bad, right? He's there for us when we feel sad. He's there for us when we feel happy. So what I want you guys to do this week is I want you to focus on your friends. I want you to look at your friends at school, and if your friends seem tired or your friends seem overwhelmed, smile. Give them a hug. Help them carry their books. If they seem happy about something, ask them what they're happy about, because we're supposed to share being happy too. So we're supposed to share the happy times and the sad times. That's what Jesus wants us to do, not just be there when our friends are sad, but be there when they're happy. So be observant this week. Watch your friends, watch your family, watch your mom, watch your dad. share their burdens. If they're tired, help them out. If they're happy, smile and laugh with them, right? So can we hold hands and pray? Can we hold hands and pray? You don't have to participate if you don't want to, Nathan. Okay. Dear God, thank you so much for children in church. Thank you for the opportunity to teach them how to love each other and how to love community. Lord, we ask that you send them out into their schools, into their preschools, to be the light of you into the world of darkness, Lord. Thank you so much for our children. In Jesus' name, amen. Now they're going to have bucket time and collect change for our mission in Honduras. You can put it in the bucket.
First Thessalonians 1:1-10 will be our scripture today. I lose sticky pads, but I don't lose my hand. If you want to do children's time or help with the offering, help ushering, say the offertory prayer, greeters, get with Sergeant Carter there on the front row. And he'll put you to work in Sergeant Carter. Sergeant Carter, Sergeant Carter. Remember that one? Show my age. Let's stand for the reading of God's Word, please. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfast hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that He has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit, and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols, to serve a living and true God, and to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The Word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. You know, this is one of our oldest books, our oldest letters. It predates the Gospel of Mark, which is our first gospel. So it was written in about 20 years following the death and resurrection of Christ. So it's still fairly new on the people's mind there in Thessalonica. Paul liked those folks a lot. Spent about 3 weeks there. And they never left his heart and mind. He starts off by saying, "We give thanks, always give thanks to God for all of you." All of you. I am always amazed in churches, and thank goodness it's not so here, that where you have pews or tables or chairs or anything else, they got little brass name tags on them. You know what I'm talking about? Because those people are more important than everybody else, right? Well, everybody thinks they are. Oh, I made the mistake one time moving a chair. Oh, no. I didn't stay there long, by the way. They got real upset with me about moving Grandma's chair. Well, it was falling apart. That's why I moved it. I was scared I was going to break my neck. He says, we're not naming individuals, but all of you. God says, Paul says, I am thankful for all of you, all of your church. This church is not just two or three people. It's all of us that he says, I give thanks to all of you, mentioning you in our prayers. Come thy fount of many blessings. We need to name folks. When we pray, we don't say, oh, God bless all of us. It's God bless Don and Mark. We look for people. Because I'm going to tell you what happens when you name folks. Is when you name folks, you become connected with them. You have a connection now. You remember their pain or their joy or whatever else, and you become a part of it. It says we mention you by name. I remember the bishop came to a church service at one of the churches I served. He preached that day, and of course, I did the same thing I do here. I say, you know, do you have prayer concerns from the congregation? And, you know, people would call him out, and then I name. He says, I've never noticed folks just name them. It's like, Bishop, come on, man. I'm supposed to be, you know, sucking up to you, not the other way around. You know, you name people. It's not just a generic thing. But we name those whom we love and are constantly remembering you before God. When we pray, do we constantly remember those folks that are suffering? Or only when we see it on the news? I mean, let's face it, folks. We went through Katrina, right? And people really like talking about Katrina for a week or two, maybe even a year. But after that, they said, that's old news. We're going to something else. But there are still people suffering. It's the same way. We remember the atrocities, you know, until the next thing comes along. We pray for the school children that get shot in a school shooting. And then we forget about them the next week because now we're going to have something else on our plate. It says constantly remembering you. It's not a hit and miss proposition. It's not just a time of crisis. But always we remember the orphaned, the widowed, and the sojourner. Paul says, I remember this about you guys. Y'all had great work of faith. Work of faith. You ever wonder why we work? Do we work just to make money? Do we work just because it's a duty? No, in the church, he says we're to work because of faith, okay? We work because that's what God gives us. You know, I don't think we talk about it enough, but every vocation is a calling. It doesn't matter if you're an engineer, if you're a doctor, if you're a band director, if you're a teacher, whatever you accountant, whatever it is you do, God has called you into that vocation. And I don't think we understand that sometimes. That's that work of faith. You know, that we have come to this place because that is what God has called us to do. mine is not the only calling. Paul says, y'all labor of love. Y'all remember the story of Jacob, don't you? You remember? Whenever Jacob was promised Rachel, you remember that story? And he says he worked 7 years. It was but a week. You know, just time passed because he was so in love with her. And he got the other sister instead. He wasn't a very happy camper. And he had to work 7 more years to get what he was promised the first time. And he says it was torture, you know? When we work for Christ, when we have passion about it, that's love. That's a labor of love. That we love the Lord so much that we just, it's not hard. It's not tiresome. I don't know if y'all paid attention recently about Glenn Campbell. I know some of y'all don't know who he is. He's an old guy, okay? whenever he started his farewell tour, he started it, by the way. I don't know if y'all remember this. He started it down here. He did the practicing down here for it. He had Alzheimer's, came out, and he does have Alzheimer's, came out and said, I have it, but I'm still going to do this farewell tour. And his kids say it's really interesting. That tour, by the way, ended up being 151 cities, 400 and something days. They now made a movie about it. But his kids say, you know, it's just something that he wouldn't remember to tie his shoes, but to get on stage and all of a sudden it just clicked. Everything clicked for him. That's a labor of love. That's what it's like whenever you can be as tired as all get out, but you know that God wants you to do something. And will give you that strength in it. And it's a labor of love. He says, I remember the labor of love, the steadfastness of hope in Jesus Christ. Viktor Frankl was a prisoner, a Jewish prisoner in World War II in the concentration camp. He was a psychiatrist, and he wrote a wonderful book. But in his book on the search for meaning, Man's Search for Meaning, he says the one thing that kept him going was hope. He had a hope. That and love, by the way. I thought that was interesting. I wonder sometimes if we don't just give up our hope in Christ. It comes when spurts and starts and all. He says a steadfastness of hope in Christ. For you know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God. Beloved by God. That was the term for Moses and for others that were the beloved by God. But now he says this to the Gentiles, that they are chosen. There's something I wanted to speak on. I got to make sure I don't go ahead of myself. Nope, I'm good. It says God has chosen you. Pay attention to that. God chooses us. God takes the initiative to find us, not the other way around. We always think it's on us. No, God has found us. God chooses us. You remember what it was like when you were, it finds folks my age. Y'all remember what it was? Well, they're too young in some places, man. Y'all don't understand. Y'all didn't play sandlot baseball. Y'all have to have a baseball field with the little gloves and the $300 bat and the $200 pair of shoes that you're going to outgrow before the season's over. You know? We just taped that bat together with electrical tape and nails. But you remember going out, yeah. You remember going out and playing sandlot baseball, and your best friend was the captain of the team, and you couldn't wait to be picked. You remember that? And what would happen when your best friend picked you? Whoo, man, you're unstoppable, weren't you? You just went out there and played as hard as you could. But if the other guy chose you and you had to play against your best friend, how well did you play? You know what I'm saying? It was kind of half-heartedly. Or if you were the last one chosen, it was even worse. He says, God has chosen you. Our friend, our best friend, has chosen us to play on that team. I think that's pretty marvelous. Myself, that we have been chosen. Then he goes, whoops, be right back. One of the preachers I was talking to yesterday during the lay leadership thing yesterday said, yeah, if somebody asked why they move so much, said, well, a moving target's hard to hit. And the little kid, yeah, the kid said, yeah, but if you stand behind the pulpit, if they start shooting, you got somewhere to go. Y'all wondered why I wanted this pulpit back in here so bad, don't you? Yeah. That's always my answer. Somebody says, how are things at Wesley? They ain't shooting at me. Most folks ain't shooting at me, I'm good. I think this is where I wanted to look at something else that I didn't have in my notes. Let me see. Nope. It says, because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only. Not in word only. We can talk a big game all day long. And I think this is why folks don't want to go to church. I'll be honest with you. Because we will talk a big game, but we don't do squat. We act differently than what we say. It says that it is a power in that name. It is a power in the Spirit. You know, it's more about how we act than it is about how we talk. Are we with me on that one? Good? Okay. We have to live the message. You know, then we got no fear because we got the power. We've got the power of the Spirit if we will live the message with full conviction. You can't half-heartedly do this. It doesn't work. People can see through that. They won't come back. They won't listen to your message if you half-heartedly do it. If you read it out of a book, it ain't gonna work, okay? It's got to be full throttled ahead to be effective. Anyway, maybe when we see the decline in the relevance of church for some people, we have become not a whole lot different than the Kiwanis or the Rotary or the baseball team or whatever else because we half-heartedly do it. You know what kind of person we proved to be among you for your sake? They were really willing. Paul was willing to practice what he preached. Somebody said in Sunday school today, said it's a lot easier to say than it is to do, isn't it? And there's truth to that. There's a lot easier to say how to do something than it is to do it. Paul didn't go in there and say, y'all do as I say do. He went in there and did. And they said, that's good. That's how the early church started. The early church wasn't about knocking on doors and evangelizing. The early church was about how you live. There was a transformed life, and people wanted that. People said, there's something about you that's different than it was the last time I met with you. What did you do differently? And they taught them how to live a life of faith. They didn't slap them upside the head with the Bible. It says, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord. There's an old story about a mama crab teaching her baby crab how to walk. And the baby crab would follow along, and mama kept saying, no, 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 you're going sideways. You're going sideways. And he said, but mama, that's the way you're going. It's kind of good. See how that rolls out? Finally, it takes a few seconds to get there, but it's good. Do we want folks to imitate us? I mean, think about it. I mean, especially those of us with young children. You know, when we say or do something and then we see our kids do it and we think it's really bad when they do it. But it was okay when we did it. I never have understood how curse words became adult language. A little childish to me, but you know. How did they become adult language? I can't wait to be adult. I can say that word, right? That tells everybody I'm an adult. How can we expect children to be responsible adults, to be growing Christians, if we don't give them an example? I mean, isn't that what we say in the baptismal covenant? We say, we're going to take care of this child. We're going to help this child get to that point that we're going to model it for that child. I know. What can you expect? It says, yeah. Don't go anywhere just yet. Here. I'll put an X on there. It says, in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy. These people, think about it. We're not persecuted in America. I don't care what the news media tells you. I don't care what the internet tells you. There is not a Christian in America that is persecuted. They ain't persecuted. And we have the right to believe anything we want to believe or not believe in America. Right? So we don't have to worry about if I decide I will be a Christian, somebody will slice my head off. Do I? They did. But it says, how did they receive the word? With joy. We don't even receive the word with joy, and we got all the freedoms in the world. Amazing. Maybe. I wonder, maybe if we were in a place that was persecuted, maybe we would appreciate it. Maybe we would really appreciate that salvation that is offered to us. I don't know. What I know. I'm just a dumb redneck preacher. You became examples for all folks. If you look at how they did this, I mean, everybody knew about these folks at Thessalonica. Okay? Now, I understand it's on a trade route. Okay? It's a big trade route. But everybody knew about these folks and what good works they were doing, what faith they had, that they were transmitting the gospel all over. Everybody knew it. Hey, guess what, Tammy? They talked about radical hospitality in this thing. Did you notice that? How much you received us. I wonder sometimes how folks hear about us. Here we go. So I got my X. I know where I'm going now. Welcome. We already talked about that. It says that you have turned to God from idols and have decided to serve a living and true God. I look at some church programming, and that's all it is programming. And I think, is that really what we're doing? I mean, the Methodist movement, the whole Methodist movement came out about the prophetic word. That's what it was about. It wasn't about music programs. It wasn't about kids programs. It wasn't about softball. It was about preaching the word of God. That's it. And we've chased after idols of all kinds. It says they got rid of the idols and started worshiping the true God and a living God. We don't serve a dead God. I don't understand people. They say that God doesn't speak anymore. We ain't listening anymore. That's what's happened. We quit listening. And guess what? To wait for his son from heaven. Woo. We got to wait. Understand, this is about one generation after Jesus has resurrected. What did Jesus say? There are those among you that will not die before I come back. Wait on the Lord. Maybe that's part of our problem. I call it the medicalization of spirituality. Maybe that's part of our problem. We live too long. I mean, seriously. I mean, you got folks who live 90, 100 years old. So I worry about it. This whole spiritual stuff when I get older. Why do I need to worry about it now? I don't know. We don't want to wait. We think we can make Jesus come now if we wanted him to. We have to wait to see what God wants us to do. Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. Y'all know what the one prerequisite it was to join the Methodist movement? The desire to flee from the wrath to come. We don't think there's going to be any. We don't. We're going to outlive God. That's what we think. Seriously. We don't. We say that we believe in the second coming, but we really don't. Because if we believed in the second coming, we'd act different. If we believed Jesus was on his way back now, we would act differently. At least I hope we would. Some people may not. I don't know. If you think you're acting okay for Jesus to come back right now, would you please not stand close to me? Because when that lightning hits, I don't want to get burned. Right? So, what is it we can take home with us today? The message of the gospel is not in words alone. We've got to act on our faith if that message of love is to go out. We can't come in these doors and walk out the doors and talk about folks. We can't come in these doors and talk about love and walk out talking about hate. You know? Do we want people to imitate us? I mean, really? If we don't want people to imitate us, then maybe we ought to change. Just a suggestion. And Jesus is the only one who can save us from the wrath to come. Amen. I'm a done. So, was that me?
Yeah.
Man, I pulled my tie. That's why it's called a lapel mic, right? Not a tie mic. One of those days. If God has spoken to your heart, if you want to just spend some time at the kneeling rail, as Andy plays a pretty song, the altar is open for all who wish to spend some time. Thank you. prepare to go from this place, let us stand together and affirm our faith as found on page 881. By the way, the apostles never used this. We don't see where they ever did. It just happens to come from about that time frame. And it was really a question and answer of what do we believe? We believe in a universal church. That's the Holy Catholic Church. We believe that all of the church, we ain't got all the answers. Everybody is in this boat together. We believe in the forgiveness of sins. It says, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus.